Today we're going to be talking about the Briggs-Rauscher reaction. This reaction is quite unique because it's one of the very few oscillating chemical reactions that we know of. Three colorless solutions are mixed, and it slowly becomes darker and darker yellow until it suddenly turns black. The black color slowly fades and the solution momentarily reverts back to being colorless. It then starts to become yellow again, and the cycle repeats itself several times. It's similar to an iodine clock reaction where a colorless solution quickly turns black. However, the iodine clock doesn't oscillate, and the reaction is over once it changes colors. There's another famous oscillating reaction known as the Belousov-Zabotinsky reaction, and I plan to cover it in a future video. For this reaction, we need to make three separate solutions, and these are all the ingredients that I used. For solution A, I used potassium iodate and concentrated sulfuric acid. Concentrated sulfuric acid is normally colorless, but mine got a little bit dirty, so it has this yellow tint. Although it's discolored, it's still quite pure, and it will work fine for this reaction. For solution B, I used cornstarch, malonic acid, and manganese sulfate. Some guides for this reaction claim that the malonic acid can be replaced by acetone, but I tried this and it didn't seem to work. For solution C, all I need is some 30% hydrogen peroxide. I'm going to be making 1 liter of each solution, but the quantities can easily be scaled to any volume. For example, if you instead want to make 100 milliliters of each, you can just divide everything by 10. Okay, so now I need to make the solutions, and I'm going to start with solution A. Into a plastic container, I add about 1 liter of distilled water. It's very important to use distilled water because chloride ions in tap water will ruin the reaction. I turn on the stirring, and I dump in about 43 grams of potassium iodate. Even with strong stirring, this is going to take several minutes to fully dissolve. After about 10 minutes, it looks like everything has dissolved, so I add the sulfuric acid. As I said before, my sulfuric acid was slightly discolored, so the solution here becomes a little bit yellow. This is perfectly fine and it doesn't affect the reaction, but it does make me a little bit sad because all of the solutions are supposed to be colorless. I let it mix for something like 30 seconds, and then I turned off the stirring. At this point, I'm done making the first solution, so I mark the lid and the container with a letter A. This is placed on the side, and I move on to making solution B. The first thing that I need to do is make a starch solution. So into a beaker, I add a small amount of cornstarch, followed by a bunch of distilled water. I mix things up using a glass stir rod, but the cornstarch isn't really going to dissolve. To get it to dissolve, I need to heat it up, and the easiest thing to do is to put it in the microwave. So in the microwave, it's brought to a boil, and I continue to boil it for something like 5 or 10 seconds. Although this clears up the solution quite a bit, it's probably still going to be cloudy. Anyway, the starch solution is placed on the side, and I continue making the other part of solution B. Into another plastic container, I add about 650 milliliters of distilled water. Into the water, I add manganese sulfate, and I stir until everything dissolves. When I have a nice and clear solution, I add the malonic acid. Once everything has more or less dissolved, I add the starch solution from before. I stir the solution for a few minutes to make sure that it's mixed really well, and then I take out the stir bar using a magnet. I label the lid and the container with the letter B, and I move on to making solution C. Into a freshly cleaned container, I add about 400 milliliters of 30% hydrogen peroxide. On top of this, I pour in 600 milliliters of distilled water to give a total volume of 1 liter. I turn on the stirring and I stir it for something like 30 seconds. The stir bar is removed and then everything's labeled with the letter C. At this point, we should be done, but there's actually a problem with solution B that I need to attend to. In solution B, some starch started to fall out of solution, and this needs to be filtered off. This is very easily done by just passing it through a coffee filter. The starch solution was quite hot when it was added, so it heated things up. As the solution cooled, the solubility of starch decreased and it started to precipitate. Some starches are more soluble than others, so depending on the starch that's used, this step may or may not be required. What I'm filtering here is still slightly warm, and this isn't really a good idea. It does clean up the solution, but it's kind of pointless because as it continues to cool, more starch is going to precipitate out. The best idea is to just be patient and to only filter things after it reaches room temperature. Once everything had filtered through, the funnel was removed and I labeled the container. I let it sit for a couple hours to cool down, and I refiltered it before moving on. Okay, so all of the solutions are now made, and I can move on to the reaction. Although A is slightly discolored, you'll see in a minute why it doesn't really matter. The reaction uses an equal amount of each solution, but it's important to mix A and B first. So I fill a beaker about a third of the way with A, and then I add B. The addition of solution B takes away the yellow color, but I'm not exactly sure why. The impurity that's present is somehow reacting with solution B and becoming colorless. If any of you guys think you know what's going on, I'd love to hear your theories in the comments. Anyway, with A and B added, I turn on the stirring, and at this point, not much should be happening. The magic happens when I add solution C, which contains the peroxide. Okay, so now to explain what's going on. It's honestly pretty complicated, but I'm gonna try to make it understandable. The major variable in this reaction is the concentration of iodide. When the concentration is low, the process that generates it is favored, and when the concentration is high, the process that consumes it takes over. This causes the iodide concentration to fluctuate up and down, and it's responsible for the oscillating effect. Before I get into more detail, I'm first going to recap all of the chemicals that were used. In solution A, we have potassium iodate and sulfuric acid. In solution B, there's starch, malonic acid, and manganese sulfate. And in solution C, we have just hydrogen peroxide. When all of the chemicals are mixed, there's a whole slew of reactions going on, but they can all be added together to make one overall equation. Under acidic conditions, the iodate ion from potassium iodate, malonic acid, and hydrogen peroxide all react together to form iodomalonic acid, oxygen gas, and water. The manganese is acting as a catalyst, and the starch is used as an indicator. While it's useful to know what's happening overall, this scheme doesn't really explain why the reaction oscillates. To really understand this, we're going to have to look at the intermediates that are being formed. The overall equation is the sum of two main steps, which I've labeled as equation 1 and equation 2. In the first one, iodate reacts with hydrogen peroxide to form hypoiodous acid, oxygen, and water. In the second one, hypoiodous acid is consumed when it reacts with malonic acid to form iodomalonic acid and water. The first reaction can occur by two very different processes. One is called the radical process, and the other one is called the non-radical process. Although they have the same overall equation, their subreactions are quite different. The oscillation of this reaction comes from the switching between these two processes. The process that dominates at any given time is determined by the concentration of iodide in the solution. If we look at the subreactions of the two processes, we can see that the non-radical one involves iodide in multiple steps, but the radical one doesn't use it at all. When we first start out, there's no iodide present, so the radical process will dominate because it doesn't need it. The radical process is quite fast, and it produces hypoiodous acid faster than it can be consumed by equation 2. Because of this, there's an excess of hypoiodous acid floating around, which can react with hydrogen peroxide to form iodide. The iodide that forms then reacts with more hypoiodous acid to form iodine, which gives the solution a yellow color. The yellow color gets darker and darker as the concentration of iodine increases. The concentration of iodide will continue to increase until it eventually starts combining with iodine to form the triiodide ion. When the triiodide forms, it quickly complexes with starch to make a dark blue-black complex. At some point after the solution turns black, the concentration of iodide gets high enough that the non-radical process takes over and the radical process is shut down. The non-radical process is slower though, and it doesn't generate hypoiodous acid very quickly. Because of this, the hypoiodous acid is consumed by equation 2 faster than it can be generated. Without an excess of hypoiodous acid floating around, we stop generating iodide through its reaction with the peroxide. The non-radical process slowly uses up the iodide, and the concentration decreases. The triiodide complex with starch falls apart, and the blue color starts to fade. Iodine slowly reacts with malonic acid, and because no more is being made, its concentration drops and the yellow color fades as well. The concentration of the iodide eventually gets low enough that the non-radical process is shut down and the radical process takes over again. It starts to generate iodide again, and the process repeats itself. The reaction oscillates several times, but eventually either the iodate ion or the malonic acid is used up. Okay, so this was all probably quite confusing, but I hope it was still somewhat understandable. Just for fun, this is an original oscillogram from Briggs and Rauscher in 1972. They measured the concentration of iodide throughout the reaction, and you can see that it's constantly oscillating up and down. Anyway, now we're done with all the complicated stuff, and we can move on to just playing with the reaction. One interesting thing to do is to mix all of the solutions together, but to not stir them. Without the stirring, the reaction isn't uniform, and I think it gives it a cool effect. In the last run, the reaction seemed to be occurring sooner at the top than the bottom, so I wanted to see if I could exaggerate this effect by using a grad cylinder. During the reaction, it looked like there was a lot of fluid movement, and I think it kind of mixed itself. In the other reaction, it maintained a steady gradient from the beginning to the end, but after a couple cycles in this one, it seemed to become more or less uniform. For the last run, I sequentially added it to 4 different beakers, and I'll play it back in 4 times speed. When the reaction is done, the solution just goes black, but if you leave it there for longer, it looks like this. At the bottom, we have solid iodine, and the solution has this brown color. Before we can dispose of it, we first have to do a few things. All of the iodine and the hydrogen peroxide are neutralized using sodium thiosulfate. At some point, once we've added enough sodium thiosulfate, the purple color will disappear. However, it will probably slowly turn yellow and revert back to being purple. This means that there's still iodine present, and I just need to keep adding more sodium thiosulfate until it stays colorless. I was running out of space in this small beaker, so I switched it to a 1-liter beaker. Also, I started just adding solid sodium thiosulfate instead of dissolving it first. Eventually, I've added enough and the solution stays colorless. The next thing that I need to do is remove the manganese from the solution. It's very easy to do this by pouring in some saturated sodium carbonate solution. Very quickly, the solution becomes opaque and manganese carbonate starts to precipitate. The addition of the sodium thiosulfate generated heat, and before filtering off the manganese carbonate, I'm gonna wait till it cools down a little. All of the manganese carbonate that was caught in the filter was added to my solid waste. The liquid that passes through can be poured down the drain with a bunch of extra water. I finally got my NileRed beakers, and I've opened up an online shop to sell them. The website is just nilered.ca, and if any of you are interested in checking it out, there's a link in the description. Right now, the site only accepts orders from Canada or the US, so if you're from somewhere else and you want to get something, just send me an email at this address here. So as usual, I'd like to thank everyone who's supporting me on Patreon. Everyone who supports me will see my videos 24 hours before I release them to YouTube. On top of this, all of my supporters can directly message me on Patreon with any questions or comments that they have. And I do my best to respond within about a day or so to all of my Patreon messages. If you support me with $5 or more, you'll get your name at the end of the video like you see here. Here's just a small list of some of the future videos that I'll post. If you guys have any other ideas, please let me know in the comments.